Cutler and Penrod, 1989, The Eyewitness, The Expert Psychologist, and The Jury. Background. This is the second study we will be looking at from reaching a verdict and from persuading a jury as part of your A2 psychology course. It is further categorised into both persuasion and expert witnesses. Reaching a verdict and persuading a jury consider the legal system. This specific study covers the effects of expert witnesses on jury verdicts. Background study, Hovland and Janis, 1959. They proposed the Yale model of persuasion, which suggests there are a number of factors to consider when attempting to persuade an audience. They proposed four factors: the source, the message, the recipients, and the situation. The source of the message must appear credible and non-biased to have persuasive impact. The message must have some emotional appeal, and the most important information should be presented first. Recall the primacy effect. The recipient's resistance to persuasion is important, and this can be reduced by making the situation more informal. The situation can be made more informal by the use of jokes, eye contact, and using the audience's first names. Aim: to investigate whether the presence of an expert witness would affect the juror's decision-making ability. So, with the background study in mind, we've got to consider that if the background study is correct, then an expert witness should be a very credible source. And in a courtroom, it will be quite formal, so we wouldn't expect them to be trying to be informal as an expert witness, but it may happen, and that may affect the juror's decision. This is what this study is considering. How does the expert witness who's giving evidence affect how the jury makes a decision? Method and design. A laboratory experiment using a videotaped mock trial of a robbery. Participants: 538 undergraduates who were given extra credit in their introductory psychology course. Procedure: the participants were divided into groups of between 2 and 8 and were shown the videotape of the robbery. There were four independent variables. Witness identifying conditions, these were either good or poor. The witness confidence, this was either good or poor. The expert opinion expressed was either high or low. The form of expert testimony was either descriptive or statistical. If it was descriptive, it was easy to understand. If it was statistical, it was using a more psychological lexicon, which could make it difficult for the person to understand. So, witness identifying conditions, good or poor. In the good condition, the robber did not have a gun or any disguise. There was only a 2-day delay in the witness providing identification. In the poor condition, the robber had a gun, recall, weapons focus, and wore a disguise. In this condition, there was a 14-day delay in the witness providing identification. Just quickly now, try and recall which study it was that we looked at, weapons focus. Expert opinion expressed, high or low. In half of the trials, the expert witness, the psychologist, would rate the eyewitness on a scale of 0 to 25. Low ratings were given when the participant was in the poor witness identifying group, and high ratings were given to the good witness identifying conditions. Form of expert testimony, descriptive and statistical. In the descriptive condition, as we mentioned, the expert psychologist used ordinary language to describe how different factors can have an impact on the accuracy of eyewitness testimony, whereas in the statistical condition, the psychologist stated statistics and used a more psychological lexicon, which was more likely to baffle the jury. Now, a quick point here, the jury in the experiment were psychology students, so they may not have been baffled by such use of psychological lexicon. Then again, the students were on an introductory course to psychology, so it may have actually still baffled them. Then the participants completed a questionnaire alone. This questionnaire contained the dependent variables, of which there were three. Dependent variable number one, guilty or not guilty. Dependent variable number two, how confident are you in your verdict? Dependent variable number three, memory of the trial and of the expert witness's testimony. Findings. Jurors gave more guilty verdicts when the witness identification conditions were good. This increased if the psychologist used simple descriptive language. Juror confidence was more in the witness in the good witness identification conditions. Jurors also expressed more confidence when the eyewitnesses claimed to be 100% confident in their identification of the robber. 85% of jurors remembered the trial accurately, and memory of the psychologist's testimony was also good. They recalled correctly what the expert said about weapons focus, disguises, and delays in identification. Conclusions. The expert witness's testimony improved the juror's knowledge of factors that might affect the accuracy of eyewitness testimony and made them pay more attention to the witness identification condition. There was no evidence to suggest that jurors were sceptical about the eyewitnesses based on the expert witness's testimony. Cutler and Penrod 1989 evaluation. Weakness, ecological validity. This is one of the biggest issues for the study. The jury was composed entirely of psychology students, who of course are not representative of a jury in real life, which would have a wider range of people and ages. Furthermore, the participants were divided into groups of between 2 and 8. This was not representative of a jury of 12. In furtherance, the jury saw crimes on video, which would not happen in a regular trial. However, it could be argued that there was some ecological validity as the jury deliberated in groups, which does not happen in all studies of this kind. Then again, the groups weren't 12, they were only between 2 and 8. And there is significant evidence to suggest that having smaller numbers in a jury can lead to minority and majority influence having different effects, which we will get onto later in the course. A strength is construct validity. The results do show support for the Yale model of persuasion. A weakness is the lack of qualitative data. It doesn't provide us with any detail, and we can't look at any evidence for that will tell us about the jury's understanding of the trial and their verdicts that they really made. There is some qualitative data, just not enough. Reliability is a strength because of the large sample and the lab experiment. Weakness, demand characteristics. Again, as participants were given course credit for their participation, we can argue that some of the results may be due to the participants trying to act in a desirable way to the experimenters. It's likely that they may also, because they are psychology students, would be being experimented on by their lecturers. Now, they're probably going to want to be in the good books of their lecturers, so this could further demand characteristics witnessed in the study. A weakness is ethnocentrism. The study only used American psychology students. This, of course, is not a representative sample and therefore cannot be generalised to other countries or even the legal system in the United States. Strength. The use of quantitative data is easy to compare and analyse, which makes it easy to establish cause and effect through statistical significance. Remember, this is not an exhaustive list of evaluative points. There are many more, and it's highly recommended that you think of your own ones, because this is a very key thing that you may need to know in the exam, because if you get in the exam and you're trying to remember evaluative points, you will be slightly slower than if you just know, oh, a laboratory experiment will do this, and you know the strengths and weaknesses innately almost. If you've enjoyed this PsychYogi presentation, why not subscribe to keep up with all the latest videos?